appreciate it.
Yeah, it's very important we communicate what we're doing to the public. We're very interested in making sure everyone knows what we're doing. We're not, we're a civilian space agency dedicated to science and research and so on. So we're very, very keen to make sure that the taxpayers know what we're doing and everything. So,
well, you know, when the article came out in the major newspapers, including the Huffington Post, there was no mention of lithium, not one. Not one mention of lithium until I heard the recording of the actual, I listened to it. I listened to the rockets go off. I had no idea there was going to be a lithium dispersed until I heard payload lithium disperse.
Right. There was lithium dispersed, and I'd be happy to talk to you about it. I think you might be under some misconceptions about what we're doing, but I'm happy to tell you any details that you need.
Well, I know that it says in your article that you're doing it for communications.
Okay, I'm happy to talk to you more about it. There are many reasons we're doing it.
Okay.
We don't understand how the wind in the upper atmosphere moves.
Mm-hmm.
In these chemtrails, there's different kinds of chemtrails, as you probably know. Different trails at night we use and different trails during the day. The wind blows them around. They glow either on their own or from scattered sunlight. We take pictures and we can see how the wind trail moves around and use that to infer what the wind is. Just like if you were taking a picture of an airplane contrail. Use that to see how the wind was blowing up at those altitudes. This is much higher altitude, so we use these chemical trails.
And what is the purpose of knowing what the wind's going to do in the ionosphere?
The purpose is the ionosphere is really to understand our planet. It's very fundamental science. We're trying to understand every day we know there's electric currents that flow over the head. They're just naturally there. They've been there for, you know, ever since the Earth had an atmosphere and a magnetic field. And the wind is driven by the sun. The sun heats the atmosphere. The wind blows. And every day that wind drives an electric current. And we're trying to understand what causes that, essentially how does it work in detail. And also importantly, when the sun becomes active with lots of sunspots and lots of magnetic activity, that changes the wind pattern and changes the electric current. So we want to understand both what it is on a regular day when there's no solar activity and then what it is when there's a lot of solar activity.
Is there some other kind of a way that you can use it without using dispersing the lithium?
We're researching other ways. The lithium is actually harmless to the environment, and we could show you more about that. But it is tricky to use because we have to. It's very faint. You can't see it with your naked eye. You have to, you know, have special cameras to see it and so on. So we don't like to use it for that reason. It's hard. It's, in other words, it's hard measurement to make. We're researching other ways to put sensors directly on the rocket to measure the wind, and those are ongoing. We're trying to develop those now. In fact, one of the purposes of this mission was to do that.
Okay. Well, you've explained it to me then. I don't agree with it, but I appreciate you explaining it to me.
Mel, too, if you have detailed questions, anything you want.
Okay, I will. I'm gonna research it a little more, and I will email you, and I appreciate you taking the time out to speak to me today, sir.
At your call. It's not often we get to hear from members of the public and people who are really interested and concerned with what we're doing, and I really appreciate your time.
I wish more people would call. I really do. I've called my senators. I've called my governor. You can't get through to anyone, sir. You can't get through to anybody.
Yeah.
I go to my city council. I live in rural North Carolina. They don't care. They laugh you out of there. There's no other recourse for us, sir, unless to talk to people directly and find out what is going on because we're paying for it.
Well, I don't know how far you are from Wallace Flight Facility. Is that easy? Is that drivable from where you are?
Where is it, sir? I don't know where it is.
It's north of Norfolk, Virginia. It's on the eastern shore of Virginia. If you're at Norfolk, it would probably take you another 2.5 hours to get there.
Uh-huh.
So if you're in North Carolina, I don't know where you are, but maybe.
Right. Yeah, I'm in western rural North Carolina near the Tennessee border.
If you have a chance, you might consider either going to Wallops, going to Goddard Space Flight Facility, which is outside of D.C. There is Clemson University, which is where all the chemical release work is done.
Oh, really? Well, that's very close to me.
You might contact those guys. They'd be happy to explain what they're doing.
Oh, that's awesome. Okay, I will do that. Just look, ask for the science department.
Well, I don't know what department they're in, but Larsen, L-A-R-S-E-N, Miguel Larsen is the lead. And he's been doing this for decades and could explain in detail what they're doing and why it's not an issue for people living. We wouldn't, you know, we would be, as a government agency, we would not be allowed, you know, to do anything that would be harmful. So he's under strict control and that sort of thing. So he can explain it to you. He can even show you around, that sort of thing.
Okay, and you said his name was Miguel Larsen with an L?
Well, A-R-S-E-N.
Okay, at Clemson. Okay, well, thank you so much, Mr. Rowland. I appreciate all of your information.
Yeah.
Thank you. Have a nice day.